Everyone, welcome back to my channel. I'm Christina, our Brightline Queen. So I actually have my bowl of soup right now. I'm just gonna kind of eat and talk to you guys. I'll show you what I'm eating. It's, I just spilled some. Broth is the best part. I don't know, there's like some steak in there. I don't know, my mom made it for me because I've been kind of sick recently, and you know that mama's soup is the best when you're sick. Today's video was about the meaning behind happy, thin, and free. I call it a sales slogan. I don't know if that's technically what it is, but it's like the motto of Brightline Eating. So happy, actually, she explained that it actually does have to do with how we eat, because when you eat things that aren't packaged, aren't coming out of bags and boxes, your omega-6 lowers. So when your omega-6 lowers, it matches with your omega-3s, and then that actually gives your brain the right fuel to like work properly, think properly, function properly. So hopefully eating this way can increase happiness. I haven't noticed any necessarily increased happiness, but what I notice is that my emotions are very stable now. But that did take a little while, because when I was first starting and I did not have the flour or sugar to kind of like take the edge off, I was a little bit feisty, honestly. Like, there were times when things were like angering me and I couldn't figure out why. And then I realized that these were triggers that I had for like many years, but I was medicating myself with the food. So when I didn't have that medication, it made me kind of edgy. I noticed that the edginess went down maybe around month 4. So that's 4 solid months of dealing with detox symptoms, honestly, because I was dealing with edginess from like being off that drug, which is kind of really intense when you think about it. So what does thin mean? Thin just means in your right-sized body. It does not mean that you need to be supermodel thin or like a Barbie girl, you know? Like, some of us, we just want to get to the highest edge of the BMI chart. Some of us don't even want to mess with the BMI chart. Some of us have muscle or bigger bone structure. At my highest weight, I was 262 while I was pregnant. And by the time I'm down to like 170s, I'm gonna be holding on to quite a bit of skin. All right, and what does freedom mean? A lot of people are confused by this because they're like, wait, we weigh and measure all our food. That isn't freedom. And you're right. It's a boundary that you put up because you want mental freedom around food. Today we went to a parade. At the parade, they were like throwing out candy to everywhere, and my daughter got tons of candy. And then in the car, I was unwrapping her piece of candy and handing it to her. Would I be able not to have a piece of candy 6 months ago? Absolutely not. Would it terrorize my mind until I had a piece of candy? Yes, I would be in mental chaos until I put that candy in my mouth. If you have not experienced food chatter, then you don't know what it's like, but some people have brains that are so susceptible to this flour and sugar thing that they just talk nonstop to us. You know, they're yakking all the time. And that's no way to live. It is miserable. It's not freedom. Another way I didn't have freedom is being afraid to go on vacation, because inevitably I would gain 10 pounds every single time. I could not enjoy my time on vacations ever, because I knew that I was gonna gain weight. Another way that I did not have freedom was health freedom. I had uncontrollably high blood pressure. I was afraid of a stroke at all times. It is like living inside a jail. I am a registered nurse. I know how to get a job done, right? So I could do Weight Watchers perfectly. I could do elimination diets perfectly. I could do fasting regimens perfectly. And could I get success after 6 months? No, nothing, ever. Nothing, and I mean absolutely nothing, has worked for me except this addiction mindset approach. So that's why I'm so passionate about it, because it actually works, and I have tried it. I know how to follow directions. I'm not talking about like 2 weeks here, a month here. I'm talking about 6 months in a row. Is something sustainable and giving you great progress? I also want to say one thing. I'm in a size large. This is actually a large t-shirt. So this is a large t-shirt. Now, you can see that this is even kind of baggy on me a little bit. So I'm in a size large right now, which is like, I think I haven't been in a size large since like 2014-ish. So it's really exciting. I'm down from XXL, so extra, extra large, in May. I started on May 22nd, so it's just absolutely incredible. I think I'm almost down 50 pounds, like 49 pounds or something like that. So one thing I really appreciate about Dr. Susan Pierce Thompson is she is not like pushy. Like in the video today, she's like, hey, if this isn't working for you, try something else. And don't stop until you find something that works for you. I just felt like that was so kind and open and honest. Even though I believe it's the best, I know it's the best for me, doesn't mean that it's gonna be the best for everybody. So I'm gonna write out my meals for tomorrow. I can't believe this whole challenge is just like whizzing by. It's been really fun to just deep dive into the modules. And hang on, I wanna say one more thing. I put a quote on my Instagram, and I never do this. I'm like not a quote type person. It says, self-sabotage is when we say we want something and then go about making sure it doesn't happen. And this is by Alice Corwin Selby. Earlier on in my journey, I definitely had some self-sabotaging thoughts that I did not act on, but I definitely had to address and get down to the root issue of why I wanted to self-sabotage. What I noticed with Brightline Eaters especially is that we know the science behind it. Like, we know it takes 8 weeks for our brain to heal. And what I notice is like people self-sabotage maybe a week in or a couple days in. If it's repeated self-sabotage, the root issue needs to be addressed because there is a fear there, a fear of getting successful basically. And that is very real. Some people are afraid to be success stories. We really need to dig deep and figure out why we feel unworthy of success. So that is something that just really touched me because I've definitely felt those self-sabotaging thoughts very heavily, especially earlier on in my journey. I just want to share that with you in case that helps bring you a little bit of clarity or just like solidarity, knowing that if you've had those feelings, I've had those feelings too. Oh, I'm still coughing. I've been like sick for like a week of this challenge. So if you made it all the way through, please give this video a thumbs up. I will see you guys tomorrow. I love you. Stay bright. Stay sober. Stay alert. You can do it. I'll see you guys tomorrow.